Hello there. There was a time when IBM PC Compatibles were much quieter than they are now. Not the fans, of course, the fans were a lot noisier. But in terms of sound card technology, back in the 80s and early 90s, a lot of IBM PC Compatibles didn't have sound cards, unless you had a lot of money and you could afford a Soundblaster or an ad lib card. Now, my first IBM PC Compatible didn't have a sound card. But there was a piece of software, this is what I've just dug out of my shoebox of floppies, that allowed you to drive sounds through your PC speaker.
Ah yes, the PC speaker, sometimes also referred to as the PC beeper or PC squeaker. It's been with us since the first IBM personal computer, the 5150. Back then it was a typical 2.25-inch magnetic driven speaker, mounted onto the case, which would provide an array of beeps if there was a hardware fault or perhaps if your keyboard just wasn't plugged in. As PCs evolved, the speaker remained with us, usually in the form of a piezoelectric device, which is much smaller and typically just dangles off the motherboard. But the PC speaker is utilised for more than just faults. Any software package can make use of a speaker through a programmable interval timer, providing a similar setup to early ZX Spectrums, with the output driven via the CPU rather than dedicated audio hardware. In typical operation, beeps can be driven by a 1-bit input. However, richer sounds can be sent using pulse width modulation. Using this method, more complex waveforms can be encoded into a pulsing signal, allowing a close approximation of 8-bit audio to be sent. This uses up more CPU time than any usual PC speaker activity, but allows for some impressive sounds in games like Space Hulk, with in-game sound effects and even speech from the rubber-lipped Terminator. Of course, if you have a sound card, then you also get music.
Carefully selected.
To the Emperor!
And the whole experience is much more pleasant. But like a lot of people, I didn't have a sound card for a number of months after obtaining my PC. So to find a driver which allowed WAV files to be played through Windows 3.11 was a revelation.
So here is the disc labelled speaker driver, standard double density, in my own fair handwriting at the age of 13 or whatever I was. Oh, I can never underestimate how exciting it is to use discs still. Let's see if this bad boy works. And indeed it does, and there is the speaker driver, dated 20th of December 1991.
This particular driver is courtesy of Microsoft in 1991. Distributed as freeware, it came bundled with various software packages, but for this video I'm only concerned with what it sounds like. Installation is a doddle through the Windows control panel, and your treat for this fleeting moment of configuration is the glorious Windows startup sound. And this is what it sounds like with a Soundblaster. It's not perfect by any means, but it was a vast improvement over this. Now those sounds, or lack of sounds, were played through emulation, but to get the real 90s speaker experience, we need to hear the sounds through that tinny little speaker. So here's how it compares to its Soundblaster driven counterpart. You may notice that moving the mouse creates a crackling sound. This is because the mouse shares interrupts and processor time with the driver, so any interaction with the system leads to some sound degradation, over what is already pretty degraded sound. And it doesn't stop there, we've covered waveform sounds, but what about MIDI? Now MIDI files don't hold a waveform as such, they just specify instructions for the sound card to interpret. It's really the last vestige of computer-generated music before CD audio came along, and used in most DOS games throughout the late 80s and 90s, thanks to the arrival of hardware like the Adlib Music Synthesizer card in 1987. But there is a Microsoft MIDI driver for the PC speaker, and it sounds like this. Not something you'd want to listen to for an extended, or in fact any period of time, as it simply converts one track of the MIDI file into beeps. It's good for composing Nokia ringtones perhaps, but pretty crap for anything else. Here's what Canyon.mid sounds like with a Soundblaster 16FM synthesis card. There were other tools which tried to make use of a PC speaker, such as Access Software's Real Sound, integrated into several games in the late 80s, and you could even desolder your speaker wire and connect it up to a stereo to have a better sound. Some sound cards even had PC speaker connections to allow the audio to come through your main speakers. Left view. But by this point, real sound cards were appearing and the technology was soon superseded, as the PC platform fought off machines such as the Amiga, which had sophisticated sound technology from the go. For me, this art of pushing hardware to its limits is utterly engrossing, and we'll be visiting some other areas of sound over the coming months, including the full story of PC compatible sound cards. Stay tuned, but until then, thanks for watching and have a good evening.